The scripture reading this morning is from the book of Esther. And I'd like to tell you a little bit about it. First of all, there is Haman. He was one of the main advisors to King Ahasuerus. And Haman instigates a plot to kill all of the Jews. And he attempts to convince King Ahasuerus to order the killing of Mordecai. Now, Mordecai was the adopted father of Queen Esther. He had adopted her when she was an orphan. She was also his cousin, but he loved Esther so very much. And the plot is foiled by Queen Esther, the king's recent wife, and Esther herself is a Jew. So the first reading is from the book of Esther, chapter 4, verse 14. For if you keep silence at such a time as this, relief and deliverance will rise for the Jews from another quarter. But you and your father's family will perish. Who knows? Perhaps you have come to royal dignity for just such a time as this. And from chapter 4, verse 16, go. Gather all the Jews to be found in Susa and hold the fast on my behalf, and neither eat nor drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my maids will also fast as you do. After that, I will go to the king, though it is against the law, and if I perish, I perish. Next is from chapter 5, verses 1 through 10. On the third day, Esther put on her royal robes and stood in the inner court of the king's palace, opposite the king's hall. The king was sitting on his royal throne inside the palace, opposite the entrance to the palace. As soon as the king saw Queen Esther standing in the court, she won his favor, and he held out to her the golden scepter that was in his hand. Then Esther approached and touched the top of the scepter. The king said to her, "What is it, Queen Esther? What is your request? It shall be given to you, even to the half of my kingdom." Then Esther said, "If it pleases the king, let the king and Haman come today to a banquet that I have prepared for the king." Then the king said, "Bring Haman quickly, so that we may do as Esther desires." So the king and Haman came to the banquet that Esther had prepared. While they were drinking wine, the king said to Esther, "What is your petition?" "It shall be granted you." "And what is your request?" "Even to the half of my kingdom, it shall be fulfilled." Then Esther said, "This is my petition and request. If I have won the king's favor, and if it pleases the king to grant my petition and fulfill my request, let the king and Haman come tomorrow to the banquet that I will prepare for them, and then I will do as the king has said." Haman went out that day happy and in good spirits. But when Haman saw Mordecai in the king's gate and observed that he neither rose nor trembled before him, he was infuriated with Mordecai. Chapter 6, verses 6 through 9. So Haman came in, and the king said to him, "What should be done for the man whom the king wishes to honor?" Haman said to himself, Whom would the king wish to honor more than me?" So Haman said to the king, "For the man whom the king wishes to honor, let royal robes be brought, which the king has worn, and a horse that the king has ridden, with a royal crown on its head. Let the robes and the horse be handed over to one of the king's most noble officials. Let him robe the man whom the king wishes to honor, and let him conduct the man on horseback through the open square of the city, proclaiming before him, 'Thus it shall be done for the man whom the king wishes to honor.'" And then finally from Esther chapter 7, verses 3 through 6. Then Queen Esther answered, "If I have won your favor, O king, and if it pleases the king, let my life be given me. That is my petition. And the lives of my people, that is my request. For we have been sold, I and my people, to be destroyed, to be killed, and to be annihilated. If we had been sold merely as slaves, men and women, I would have held my peace. But no enemy can compensate for this damage to the king." Then King Ahasuerus said to Queen Esther, "Who is he and where is he? Who has presumed to do this?" Esther said, "A foe and enemy, this wicked Haman." Then Haman was terrified before the king and the queen. This ends the reading.
Thank you very, very much, Lori. Nice job on reading our scripture and introducing it to us as well. What an interesting story this is. Well, we are in our All In sermon series, and I'm glad you're here for that. The premise behind this series is that a lot of people say that they're followers of Jesus. They sit in the pews Sunday after Sunday. Wonderfully, that's great. They give to the offering. But they don't take that next step. They don't make themselves a little uncomfortable with their faith by stepping out and doing something, not knowing exactly what's going to happen, but having faith that God will bless what they're doing. And so we really need to be challenged to go all in with our faith. I know I am being greatly challenged by this book, as I'm preparing, my heart is so convicted. You know, it's easy for me to just sort of think what I do on a given week to prepare and go to meetings is enough, and that I don't need to go beyond that. But this is really challenging me to say, yeah, but you're pretty comfortable with that routine. Are you really challenging? Are you really going all in? And so I've been very convicted by this, and I hope it's doing the same for you. And as we look at this story from Esther, I want to sort of challenge us again for this all-in thing that we're doing. I want to give a little bit of a setup before what was read today. What's going on? Well, the king had some assassins that were looking to kill him. And Mordecai warned Queen Esther, and she told the king that that's what was happening, and he was saved by Mordecai. And therefore, the king, Mordecai, was in his favor. The king was sort of a very, really liked himself. Narcissistic, I guess, is the word for it. And to the point where, with one of his queens, he wanted her to show herself. I'm assuming that means bare herself to some of his friends. And she refused. And therefore, she was banished. And then comes along Esther. And she becomes queen, and she's a beautiful Jewish woman. Now, Mordecai, after he did what he did, became an official in the palace. But also Haman, he was an official in the palace. He was sort of second in command. So much was he honored, Hammond, by the king, that he ordered people, when Hammond is in the room, comes into the room, you need to bow. But Mordecai, being a good Jewish man, didn't. He did not bow to Hammond. He only bowed to his God. And that infuriated Hammond, because he too was very narcissistic. He thought the world of himself. And he wanted to kill not just Mordecai. He wanted to kill all the Jews. And Mordecai got word of that. And he went to the queen, the one that he raised after her parents were killed. And he went to her and told her the plot to kill the Jews, her family, him, maybe even her. And like I told the kids, she could have said no. She could have taken a step back. As a matter of fact, she kind of did. She said, and for those following along back there, I'm on page 4 of my sermon. In fact, she says, I'm sorry. I would love to help, but look at all the comfortable things I have. Why would I risk that? So she took that step back. And that's when Mordecai said to her, maybe you became queen. God put you here as queen for such a time as this. And friends, maybe, even though we're not a queen, maybe we were made for such a time as this. Such a time as what's happening in our world. We see it every day. For such a time to take a step forward and make a box. Such a time to help with the Heifer Project, such a time to take a step forward to help with the flood buckets, and maybe such a time to step forward with Toys for Tots and beyond of just giving, but going out to do. For God has made each one of us for such a time as this. So after some thinking, Esther says, okay, I'll do what God wants me to do. But a woman, even the queen, could not enter the temple court without being summoned. And she knew that. And she knew that if she did that against the law, she could have been killed. So she decides after some fasting that she is going to do what she can. And after the fasting, on the third day of the fast, she put on her royal robes and the crown, and she went and entered the court. The first step forward that she took on this journey of faith. She probably was trembling with great fear, knowing that the king could kill her right on the spot for daring to enter his court unannounced and uninvited, a woman. But she did it. And at that moment, she was going all in. And she was trying to do what she could. God had a plan, she knew. God was with her, she knew. And so she stood there. And the king asked her, I'm on page 6 for those following along in the back. He asked her, what do you want, queen? I will give you whatever you want, up to half of my kingdom. Now, a lot of us, if we would have heard that, we would have said, a car, a truck, a world win tour of the world. But now she said, I'd like you to come to a banquet and bring him. And so he did. And Haman was there. He felt so honored to have been invited by the queen, so much so that after the banquet, he went home just puffed up. Like, look at how important I am to have been invited like the king to the queen's banquet. And at that banquet, she said, I'd like you to come to another one tomorrow and bring him. He was puffed up and walked home. And there was Mordecai at the city gates. And he did not stand when he walked by. He did not bow. He did not bow down. And it just infuriated him. And so he decided, I'm going to kill him first. Before I kill all the other Jews, I'm going to get Mordecai first. When I go tomorrow to that banquet, the second banquet, I'm going to ask the king, can I kill Mordecai? He was so sure of himself, he put an impaling pole in his yard for Mordecai. He was going to impale him as a sight to see. Well, that night, though, the king can't sleep. He's thinking about what Queen Esther. Maybe what did she really want? He's thinking about so many things, and he can't sleep, and so he gets up and asks to be read to. And being a man that thinks so highly of himself, he asks to be read to from his own book of his own life. And so he was read to, and the part that was read was how Mordecai had saved him from the assassins. And that next morning when Haman came in, like he always did the first part of the morning, the king said, how should I honor a man that's done such great things for the king? Well, Haman, of course, thought it was him.
Well, get a robe that you've worn and a horse that you've sat on and walk them through the streets and yell out, have that person yell out, see what the king does to one that he honors? And the king said, great, that's what we'll do. Please do that for Mordecai. What? Can you imagine? The embarrassment, the shame that Haman felt, the anger that he had to run about town yelling out, this is what the king does for one who honors him. So they go to the second banquet. Haman is there. Probably anger brewing, waiting for the opportunity to say, King, give me the chance. I want to kill Mordecai. But he's thinking twice about it now, of course. Here the king just honored him. Maybe I shouldn't ask. And at the same time, the king turns to Esther, now tell me, what do you want? And she takes that opportunity to say, King, I want to be saved. I want my people to be saved. For someone is looking to kill us, to annihilate us. And the king, who would dare do that? Just to my own wife. Who would dare? And she pointed, Haman. And that impaling pole was used on Haman. What a story. If you're following along back there, I'm on page 12. What a story. What a story that teaches us so much
about how God works, how when we take a step forward, God is there. Friends, are you scared of your next step? Well, God already wrote the script of the human history, and God knows how it works out in the end. Do you want to be involved in the action or just watch from a distance? Are you going to sit on the sidelines or will you jump in and charge? Will you take that step forward? Mordecai told Esther that if she didn't do the saving of God's people, that God would see it done. But she took the step forward. I wonder what would have happened if she hadn't. Friends, don't you just love people who think God needs more informants? Somebody should do something about this. Somebody should do something about that. An informant? Somebody should do something. Well, maybe somebody is you. Maybe someone is me. I'm thinking about that. Maybe God has placed that on your heart to do something. Instead of just talking about it, maybe that thing you keep talking about is your next step. What about you? What is your next step to be obedient to God? What is your next step to get unstuck? Maybe your next step is you have a drinking problem or a gambling problem or some other addiction. Maybe it's to food. Maybe it's to pornography. Maybe your next step is to ask God to help you. Maybe your next step is you're in some kind of a toxic relationship and you need to get out. Maybe your next step is to break that off with help from others ready to help and to defend you. Maybe some of you here, your next step is to offer forgiveness to that person who has hurt you. But you don't know what he or she has done to me, Pastor Susan. How can I forgive what they have done? Well, let me tell you, Jesus forgave us on the cross for putting him there. Surely if Jesus can do that, we can forgive those that have hurt us. Friends, if you don't take your next step, somebody may get hurt. Because you haven't taken it. It might be a son or a daughter or a grandson or a granddaughter. It might be a friend. It may be someone who watches you as a Christian or at least as a person who claims to be a Christian. They're watching. There are people who don't know that you don't know that are watching you. And if you don't take the next step to be obedient with God, that person is going to be led possibly in a bad direction. We don't know. Please be that person who takes the next step. When you see something, don't just point it out. Be that one that takes the next step. Pray about and work on that next step toward obedience to God. Make sure that you are all in with God in some plan of offense, stepping forward, taking charge is in what God is calling you from it.